We have a speaker in this session, Dr. Praveen Chaddah. Dr. Chaddah worked in Department of Atomic Energy for 40 years on very different and interesting topics, from low temperature physics, superconductivity, and fundamental science. He was instrumental in Department of Atomic Energy and UGC consortium that was again on publication ethics and scientific publications. He has authored more than 200 articles and has been actively contributing in this area. The topic of his presentation will be ethics in competitive research, and he has recently published a book on related topic. I request Dr. Chaddah to initiate his talk.
Yeah, I've just written a book, actually published just about a month back, and that is why I'm here. I'm basically a physics person. I will, of course, not be covering what all is in the book. I'm just going to cover some small part, which I've been worrying about for the past 6-7 years. The first thing is that I'm talking about competitive research. It looks like an oxymoron term, because research is always competitive. Research is about creating new knowledge, and you cannot create the same new knowledge twice. So you are either the first one to publish something, or you are an also-ran. If you are an also-ran, you cannot publish in a good journal, and you'll have difficulty getting your PhD, etc., etc. So you have to be the first, and this becomes more important when you are really at the cutting edge. Why must we publish? This would have been told to you by everyone. We have to publish because if we think we have found new knowledge, then we have to convey it to others, other experts, not the media. We have to convey it to other experts so that they can either validate what we claim is new knowledge, or they can contradict us and tell us where we are wrong. But these things do not necessarily happen when we submit a paper to a journal, because the paper is looked at only by a couple of referees, and they may not be able to find what is wrong in my paper. So my paper is not validated until well after it is published, until experts in the field say that it is validated. We do not publish today just for the sake of increasing human knowledge. That is a very philanthropic idea, very Brahminical. Srinivas Ramanujam just sent all his number theory work to Hardy. He didn't publish it or claim credit. But today there is no journal which will publish an anonymous paper. You have to own the paper. You have to be responsible for what is written in that paper. We, more mortal people, claim priority and credit. We get our degree, we get our promotions, we get our prizes, we get our rewards if we were the first to do something, to publish it, and the world gives us credit. We can also goof up during the process of publishing. And there are two ways in which you can goof up. I'm not talking about the research part, but the publishing part. So this talk will not be the book contains the research part, but this talk is only about the publishing part. So when you publish, your research is over, and in the process of writing up your research, you end up, I will not talk about intentional cut and paste, but you end up with unintentional cut and paste or plagiarism, and that is what I call goof up. And under the present laws, you will be punished. The UGC has mandated what should be the punishment for a research scholar, for a professor, etc., etc. Also, if you happen to become someone big later in life and you goofed up in your thesis, you will probably perish. In 2012, 6 years back, this name and shame game had already started, and this is an editorial from Nature. And the editorial was taking credit that, I hope you can read this, prominent political figures in Europe, among others, Defense Minister of Germany, Hungary's President, Romania's Prime Minister, have been forced to resign because they had plagiarized during their PhD thesis. The social network of this crab mentality is immense in India. I got a call. We know of some VCs being hounded because they are VCs today and they had done something wrong while writing their paper as a student. If someone has really committed fraud, copied someone else's paper, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about unintentional plagiarism. So, as I said, I'm very quickly going to move on to something specific in the book. I'm not covering the whole book. But one of the advice which I have given is that you must be generous and give credit where it is due. Many articles, I also have slides on the one in Nature, suggest that we should learn to paraphrase so that we have understood what the original author was saying and then we write it in our own words. It's a very noble thought, except that my professor had 25 students and he had some great paper which all of us would use in our introduction and all of us were paraphrasing it. And student one paraphrased it in his way and it went on, and by the time you hit student 25, there are only a limited number of ways in which you can paraphrase. So student 25 thinks he has paraphrased the original work, but somewhere down the line, some hobbyist comes up and says you plagiarized from student number 4 because both of you paraphrased it in the same way. So please don't paraphrase. Quote, cite, give credit. Okay. That is what can go wrong during the process of writing the paper. So far, I was just saying that one must be ethical. In spite of being ethical, one can lose credit. And that is the part I am now going to concentrate on. We can lose credit during the process of publication or after publication of our paper. How do we lose credit during publication? We lose credit during the review process. As I said, research is about being the first and not about being the second. During the review process, the referees will have a bias against unknown authors from unknown institutions, coming up with out-of-the-box ideas. There is a bias against unconventional ideas that can delay your paper and you are no longer the first. There is a bias against unconventional ideas and you get a referee report saying if you reword your statement from this to this, we can publish your paper. We reword it. That is called succumbing to review pressure and diluting your conclusions at the publication stage. You have again lost credit for what you actually had found out and were willing to put in print with your name, but you needed the publication and the journal would not let you put it in the way you want to put it. The third part, which is a bit surprising or shocking, is that reviewers can be unethical. There are many such examples. Since this is a life sciences meeting, I have picked some examples from life sciences. Interestingly, the misconduct was against authors who were from the Western world, and that is why it has made it out. There have been cases where misconduct is against, by reviewers, is against authors even from India, and it is not discussed in the Western literature. This is an editorial in Annals of Internal Medicine where someone had submitted a paper to some other journal, not to Annals of Internal Medicine. He was an American byline. And his paper was rejected, put it in his drawer. And then the same paper, sort of, same idea, appeared in Annals of Internal Medicine. And this guy said, I think he must have been the reviewer who rejected my paper in that other journal. And since the byline was American, the Annals of Internal Medicine editor went about doing an exploration, and they found, yes, it was the guy who had rejected that paper in the other journal. So he had to get the other journal editors to cooperate. It is discussed in this. I mean, that is the paper. It's not my field, but it's in life sciences. So someone from University of in Boston, Massachusetts, and the people who plagiarized it were, I think, from Italy. The reviewer who plagiarized it was from Italy. Another case, this is on some work on neem. Again, the same thing happened. Exactly the same. The paper was rejected. The reviewer who rejected it published it under his name. Not the paper, but most of the ideas under his name in another journal. The interesting thing is, in this editorial retraction, they give an explanation saying that we do check every submission using one of these plagiarism or text similarity checks. Unfortunately, the database does not include papers that have not been published, even though they were submitted to a journal, but they were not published, they were rejected. So therefore, our software could not find out that the reviewer had done something wrong. So just to repeat my slide, there are various ways in which you can lose credit during the review process. Your research is over, wonderful research, you want credit for it, you are publishing it, you submit it to a journal, and somewhere in that process, you are no longer number one. Is there a panacea? So in 2011, I had written an article in some international online journal, newsletter, called SciDevNet. At that time, it had its flag post on INSA and Indian Academy of Sciences, so I had written for them. And the editors gave this as the summary of my article. This was not written by me, this was written by the editors. Sorry. This summary. So the editors understood that researchers in the developing world need to ensure that their papers are not short-shifted by reviewers and original ideas do get due credit. And for this, one should use the preprint archives. That is the panacea I was talking about. I have written about this in Professor Lakhotia's journal. I mean, he agreed with me, that is why he published it. The emphasis on publication in high-impact journals has created the impression that pre-publication reviews serve as validation. They do not. So many fraudulent papers have been published in the best of journals. Journals earlier were meant for dissemination. After the coming of the internet age, we have much easier methods of dissemination. Journal editors have now gone on record to say our journals are there for dissemination, but more so they are there for validation. That can sometimes fail. And as I had written in this piece which he accepted, validation in science is only through post-publication confirmations and tests. And laurels, Nobel Prize is one example. It takes so many years because they want to be sure that post-publication validation has been followed. That was 2011 and 2014, and suddenly we got some respectability, Professor Lakhotia and I, because the NIH, in March 2017, issued a, what we would call an office memo, but in public domain, saying that from now on, NIH will consider all preprints. But this categorized what should be the preprint archive. It should not be your personal blog, it should not. So they have given some guidelines. And they listed the archive I was talking about as one example. I don't think they have listed bioarchive in this, but maybe they have. It was available in March 17. And it also said that it encourages investigators to use interim research projects such as preprints. And read the next line, this is from NIH, not from Praveen Chaddah, to speed the dissemination and enhance the rigor of their work. again from NIH, scientists issue preprints to speed dissemination, establish priority. So the preprint archives, if it is respectable, is one way that you can establish priority for the idea and conclusions that you had, even if you may have to succumb to the arm twisting of the referees and publish a diluted conclusion. This thing will always be there, and I have mentioned ways on which you can keep highlighting this. Ethics in Research and Publication in 2001-2, Office of Research Integrity had issued a presidential statement, and US President, and it had said that research misconduct means fabrication, falsification, plagiarism. I noted that somewhere here we say plagiarism, falsification, and fabrication, but in the original statement it was FFP. Plagiarism at that time was supposed to be the least of the ethical, unethical behaviors. This was 2001 or two. Plagiarism was again defined on the ORI's, Office of Research Integrity site, as the appropriation of another person. Another is important. Self-plagiarism is excluded as soon as you say another. Appropriation of another person's ideas, processes, results, or words without giving appropriate credit. I just want to make two points. Money has made words more important than ideas, because text plagiarism software is billions of dollars. To the scientist, ideas are much more important than words. Not true in literature, but true for science. And I will come to this point. The second point I want to make here is that I had mentioned the Clinton statement, which said FFP. And in that context, in fabrication and falsification, there is no victim. The general public is a victim. Everyone is fooled, the general public of researchers. But in plagiarism, there is an identifiable victim. I have plagiarized your work. You are the victim. Do we have a victim support system? Do we have a method of telling a potential victim how to take care? This is true of everything in life, in social life, but somehow we scientists, knowing fully well that plagiarism is the only misdemeanor in which there is an identifiable victim, are not talking about how the victim should take care of himself or herself by following some precautions. You should not become a helpless victim of idea plagiarism. Like patents, research must also be owned. See, I had written an article in Nature in 2014, which I mentioned Authenticate had reacted to because it could have hurt their business. So, a few years later, a lot of people had reacted to my article other than Authenticate. So I was looking over the internet on who all have been influenced by my article. And in the context of this workshop, I found that from University of Johannesburg, there is something called the Steve Biko Center for Bioethics. And the person there had given a talk which had been influenced by my Nature article. I'll come to the Nature article in two slides. And what he said, his name was here, I don't remember it. Frankly, I don't care if someone else uses my exact words without proper attribution. If I get a citation out of it, I am happy. My words don't need protection. And this is from life sciences, not from physics, but the idea is the same. And then, what do you need to cite? And there, it is very clear that he was referring, I mean, somewhere else he referred to the Nature article, but he was referring to an incident which I had talked about in the Nature article, which was due to me. So the kind of thing I'm talking about is not specific to physics. It is probably across all disciplines. There are cases where ideas of Indian scientists, you talk to any senior Indian scientist, 45 and above, he will tell you about this gut feeling he had that the referee was delaying his paper because he wanted to get his own one published. So there are cases where ideas of Indian scientists are plagiarized by foreign bylines, but because they are able to paraphrase, they will not show up in any plagiarism test software. This was the article I had written in Nature. It was a worldview. It's not the whole article. But I'm highlighting that I had stuck my neck out. In my opinion, okay, this is what I had said there, strike. To scientists, plagiarism of an idea strikes at the heart of research as a creative enterprise. In my opinion, scientists who plagiarize ideas, and I stand by what I wrote in 2014, I have stood by it for 4 years, are established scientists because they can assess the validity of this young fellow from an unknown university in Jharkhand giving an out-of-the-box idea. They know that the idea is valid. They have a big enough name and byline to get their work accepted, published, and cited. The guy in Jharkhand can do nothing about it. So I had written in Nature, and this was reviewed, many questions asked and published. Scientists who plagiarize ideas and results are usually established researchers who can assess the validity of published work and have publications of their own accepted and cited. Are Indians silent victims? Silent not by choice, but by compulsion, because we do not have any watchdog providing a defense mechanism to victims of plagiarism. This was the first paper I wrote in my life, presented it in the DAE conference, published it in an East European journal. Fortunately, there were only 6 groups in the world working on this, and they knew what I had published, even though it was in a nondescript journal. When a person who had bylines of Texas and Argonne National Lab took the same idea, this was a theory paper, and redid the same calculation in a different gamma ray energy regime and published in Physical Review. And I protested. I was absolutely green at that time. But because there were only 5-6 groups and they all knew about my work, he was made to publish an erratum which said that some observations in the paper had been stated previously. I was a youngster, my guide was not strong. Observations in a theory paper means ideas. It is a euphemism. I had another episode. This one was, this guy was a very big name. Zhangs are so many, I don't know whether they are a big name. And they took ideas from our paper in 2000, which was actually published in the same journal, Physics. Review, and we had published 5 papers, some in Physical Review, some in Institute of Physics Journal, and published their own paper. And at that time, the editor-in-chief of Physical Review, Martin Bloom, had just published an editorial on ethics in research. So we wrote a nice letter to him saying that please read our paper and this paper which has just appeared in your journal, and I will tell you what was the question I asked him. If you can find an explanation for this question, then don't read further. Now, this was the paper which appeared, and that is the full length of the paper, 6 columns and references. And out of these 6 columns, this much, all in highlighting, was actually textually copied. But that was not our concern. It was textually copied because we had a new idea, a new experiment, and this group redid it on a new material, and our idea was correct. So the only reason why you see some white patches is where they put in the name of their material. So I had written to Martin Bloom saying that you look at the byline of the authors, China and Helsinki, Finland, and you look at reference 6, Decker Solid State Physics, Macmillan, New Delhi, 1985. We had referred to this book in our paper because we only had the New Delhi cheap edition. We did not have the original American edition. While copying that much text, they also copied all the references, and Martin Bloom read on. Because I said, if you can figure out why guys from this country should be reading the New Delhi edition, then please don't read that. But you see the kind of erratum, I'm not reproducing the whole of it. There is no indication how closely correlated the text is. In addition, two other references to papers by those authors, which appear in the correlated portion of text in our paper, were omitted while copying. So they copied everything, but where we had our own previous work referred, they did not copy that. I gave this detailed example for you to understand that if the same thing had been done, I wrote to Current Science, to Chaddah, who was then, by Chaddah, who was then the director of a lab, to these foreigners, you would have done a Rajput to me. Rajput was the vice chancellor who was made to hang. But because it is done by them, to a Chaddah and his students, we keep quiet. There is no defense mechanism in India. In 2011, Ravo is a foreign fellow of the Bangalore Academy. They just had this erratum which appeared, and I didn't really have to do anything to get this erratum because this was something we had been publishing for 3 years, and I want to just talk about what we had learned. Not about the history of what happened. The cooling and heating in unequal field within bracket Chuff protocol, this was the erratum, first published in reference one. We apologize for this omission. They had a whole section doing this. And in that section which they had, they said the Chuff experimental protocol clearly showing the devitrification of the rested state gives unambiguous and rather visual evidence of coexisting phases. So the whole protocol was being praised and credit for creating it was being taken, even though we had by that time published so many papers in American and British journals over a period of 3 years. So this is what can happen to Indians. Why was I saved? Because what happened in 75, I forgot. But when it happened in 2001, 2004, I remembered my old experiences, and I was able to argue with Physical Review. So in between, I heard a lecture by Kurt Wodrich, who's a Nobel laureate in chemistry. And he had created a lot of new protocols in spectroscopy, NMR spectroscopy, to identify biomolecules. Maybe some of you know about proteins. In which he said that if you are doing something new, put in some time and create an acronym. In your subsequent papers, refer to that work with that acronym. He was not worried about self-plagiarism, but he was saying you have to emphasize that you had done this earlier, you have to ensure that the credit comes to you, create an acronym. So when we had actually done this work, we had already published 4 or 5 papers, but reaching the stage of being sure that we have a drastic protocol had taken us 4 or 5 years. And when we were writing that paper, I suddenly remembered Wodrich's lecture, and for 3 days, I held the manuscript. The people in my group were unhappy. I said, it's not going until I have an acronym which is pronounceable. And it worked because they copied my acronym. I want to come to something else. If you have done some research which you consider path-breaking, then you have to take some special precautions on how you are going to publish, and we now replace the word publish by disseminate, release that scientific information. Dissemination does not include releasing it to the media, but it includes releasing it to your expertise group. As was said earlier, you have to submit to a journal where the people who you want to read that paper would read it. Archives is one such place where people read it. I still read archive every morning. Okay, there is a new list. So, how do you disseminate? I will now take 2 examples. One which succeeded, they got a Nobel Prize when they had an out-of-the-box idea. One which failed, they were Indian. The one which failed. Chandrayaan 1 was sent by ISRO. There was a NASA-ISRO collaboration, and one of the tasks was to find if there is water on the moon. NASA had developed a moon rover called the Moon Mineralogy Mapper. They sent this from the spacecraft. Chandrayaan-1 did not I mean, it landed, but we did not have the technology to make these rovers, even though two Indians are co-author on the NASA paper. So it would go around picking up samples from the moon surface and analyzing for signatures of water. ISRO had an idea that they can't do this soft landing, they can't make the rover. They will have a crash probe, a one-shot experiment, and the fumes which come out from the surface of the moon, they will do a chemical analysis. So they had done that, and they had believed they had found water. Their paper was eventually published in an Elsevier journal, so it was not trash. The NASA paper appeared in Science, and the day it was published by Science, the same day, it was 24th September there, 25th September in India, ISRO held a press conference in which they said, we had actually found water 3 months earlier, but we had kept quiet about it. Why had we kept quiet? Okay, I don't have it here. He has written about it, I have written about it, and Rajesh Kochhar has written about it. Written when the event happened. They kept quiet because they wanted legitimacy by publication in a big journal. So Current Science was there. Astrophysics Archive is a very major place where astrophysics preprints are put. Nothing. ISRO newsletter, nothing. They submitted to Science. Science rejected their paper. Some grounds. They did not flush their detectors. They sent it to Nature. Nature rejected their paper. And by the time this happened, the NASA paper appeared in print. So now if you go to Wikipedia and search for water on the moon, it was discovered by NASA, and in a footnote it says, Indian scientists claimed they had found it earlier, but they released their work only later. Because the papers which were submitted and rejected have no record, no date stamp, nowhere. That is why my panacea of the archives, which was created only 26 years back, is there. So I was reminded that do we lack courage in research? Do we have the guts to sometimes be wrong? And I was reminded by something which C.V. Raman had said, that there is nothing intrinsically inferior with the quality of the Indian mind when compared to an Anglo-Saxon or a Teuton. What inhibits us is the lack of a certain courage. Sometimes we are wrong. When you do research, you cannot always be right. We are not God. I take the other example where they got the Nobel Prize, high temperature superconductivity, the prize-winning work of Bednarz and Mueller. At that time, archives was not there. So in 1986, they published their result in a journal which came to even our library, but no one read it. And did not send it to any standard journal because their paper would have been rejected. Not because they could show it was wrong, but because they could find fault, like flushing the detector, and I will tell you what the fault was in this paper. In fact, in the Nobel lecture, they also mentioned this. I mean, being in the field, we were reading the papers and we knew what is going on. So they submitted the paper, I think, in April or May. 1986, it appeared in an issue which reached our library in September, October. But no one heard about it till end of December. And in January, there was a conference in Bangalore where the participants realized about it. It was an international conference, every big name was there. And in 1 week, hell broke loose, starting from Bangalore all over the world. And what do they say in the Nobel lecture? They contacted their boss, administrative boss, who is on the editorial board of this nondescript journal, In this capacity, we solicited his help to receive and submit the paper. Although admittedly, it did involve some gentle persuasion on our part. So even for that journal, I'm almost through. Even for that journal, it was below par. And what was wrong? There are some signatures of superconductivity which were not really there, but anyone interested, I can go into details. But the title said possible, and they said the system consists of three phases. They were not able to prepare a pure sample. They knew they had three phases in their sample, and they did not know which of these three phases was superconducting. But it was a breakthrough, out-of-the-box discovery, and they got their Nobel Prize. It's not a recent phenomena. From Wikipedia, if you search for Marie Curie, in the 1890s, she was aware that publication of a research output versus dissemination of a research output. And at that time, people who were fellows of academies could announce their results during an academy lecture. So, if Becquerel, 2 years earlier, had not presented his discovery the day after he made it, the Nobel Prize for Radioactivity would have gone to Sylvanus Thompson. He could get the Nobel Prize only because he had made the announcement without submitting it to a journal. And Curie chose the same rapid means. She was not a fellow. She asked her professor to present it. I got, as I said, a lot of people have talked about what I wrote in Nature, and I got a lot of emails. This was from someone, again, in the life sciences business. Department of Forensic Medicine in Tokyo. And he had an episode where he had made a presentation in a conference, and he was scooped. Some group which heard his work went back quickly, did it, and published it. And eventually he confronted them. There were some email interactions with him. Ultimately, they told me it was my fault for presenting without publishing. So, we Indians have two. We should get the Best Sportsman Prize, but we should get the medals also. Thank you.